Hi guys, this is Brent. Welcome to Wires, Tires, and Fires, previously known as Theoretically Practical. Today we're going to be doing a TIG test against a Lincoln Dialark 250, a Miller Synchrowave 300, and an ESOB 205 IC that I already returned to my friend. That footage was filmed on a previous day. But, you know, we're really going to be talking about the question of, so you want a TIG welder, what should you do? Should you just save your pennies up and spend the big money, that multi-process machine that I borrowed is around a $4,000 machine, or do you go the cheap route? In the case of this I got off Craigslist years ago for $600 with all the wires, cables, and everything. I do a whole video on this machine and how to set it up previously. Maybe the link's up there, maybe not. And then I just recently upgraded to this Miller Synchrowave 300, and I got this at an auction for $367 with auction fees, and I did a video on this welder. That's probably also not going to be linked up there, but that's fine too. So we're just going to do a little TIG welding with these. We're just real simple. We're just going to do a line of TIG on a piece of steel bar stock, and then a line of TIG on aluminum. The first machine I did a stick weld test, but my stick rod was wet. That's why that machine didn't stick rod weld good, and I don't have any more stick rods. So we'll be skipping that for the other machines. Or maybe you won't see it at all. This isn't really gonna be like a what's better or anything like that. It's just a combination of a couple of things. I'm looking to see, I've always told that the big transformer machines like the Synchrowave and the Dialark are always gonna be smoother than the IGBT driven machines like that ESOB Rebel. So I wanna see if that's the case. So, you know, come along with me and we'll find out. I'll let you know. I mean, it's kind of, I wanna see, did I make the right choice by spending, you know, I'll call it a couple thousand dollars on older welders over time to really build up a very competent welding fleet, I guess, if you will. Or should I have just saved my pennies and gone out and bought a $4,000 multi-unit from a good, respectable company like ESOB or Miller or Lincoln Electric? I mean, I'm typically Team Blue, but that's not on purpose. That's just how I seem to be. So it's going to be simple tests here. Our TIG welding control is that all machines will be running off the same tank of argon gas, pure argon. For filler rod, we're going to be using 3/32 steel and 3/32 aluminum. These are from Harbor Freight. I buy them because they're what I can buy today, and they always seem to work fine. We're not going to try to do like small, medium, large so much. We're just going to use a single piece of steel, and I'm just going to play with how to modulate it, how it feels to me. And then we're going to also do AC welding on this lovely, dirty old piece of aluminum and see if we can get anything to go with that. So it's pretty simple, but you know, it should be okay. And really, I don't need to have thin material to feel if this will let me ramp way down or ramp way up. So that's the name of the game. We're not gonna rank them because it's not that important, but we'll see. This is the new hotness. This is the one that's trying to topple them all. This is my friend's ESOB Rebel 205 IC AC DC high frequency start. All the goodness. So yeah, we're setting up for the TIG portion of the test with the ESOB, and it's got this nice little air-cooled, genuine Heliarc TIG torch, nice quality thing. This uses a gas collet, and I use what's called a gas lens in my machine. So this is a difference. I don't think it'll make much difference to this test, but I do want to point it out. Everything will be done using 3/32 lanthanated rod for the steel and the aluminum and the brazing. So that's what you got. All right, guys, so this is gonna be mild steel. This is DC electrode positive welding, 3/32 rod. We're just gonna see how we do. Well, we melted the electrode off. I think I had my gas a little too light, so let's try that again. All right, I figured out that I was wrong. It's DC electrode negative. I never had a machine where I have to switch back and forth typically, so I don't. So let's see what we do now. Oh, there we go. let that run like a jet fan for a minute. Okay, so we made a weld. It's, you know, it's not beautiful. I'm not really trying too hard to make a beautiful weld, but, you know, the adjustability was great. It's very smooth arc, I think. It's very different from the machines I've run, but I wouldn't say it's bad. But I would say that for a TIG welder, a maximum of 200 amps, and that only has a 25% duty cycle, so you can only run it for 2.5 minutes out of every 10, which is not a lot. I think I'd run against the duty cycle with this, and I also did during this little test. I had it floored out to 205 amps. This is typically the size material I weld with, so you know, that kind of drives the amperage you're going to use a lot. So I don't know that I think 205 amps is enough. I've run a 185 amp machine before, and I found that I just felt like it just didn't have the power. So anyways, take that for what you will. I'm not disappointed in this, and I think it's great, but it doesn't have the beans, as it were. This is the ESAB Rebel TIG test on aluminum AC. I'm just cranking the amps all the way up to full, and I'm leaving the percent up and down at 70% because that's where it was set. I don't have that setting on my DialArc 250. I don't know if the settings are exactly apples to apples on the SynchroWave 300. So we'll just try to strike an arc and make a little bead here. So here's the results of the ESAB aluminum weld. They're fine. I'm not a very good aluminum welder, and this isn't very clean material. It's not necessarily what the test is about, though this would have done an adequate job. It definitely had enough power to do this kind of thickness aluminum, I would say, but probably not much more. So yeah, it works great. Again, the duty cycle is going to be pretty short with this. The one nice thing about this machine is that it'll turn itself off because of the duty cycle. I don't know about the big boys. I think they'll just burn themselves to the ground if you turn them up too hard for too long. So that's how I feel about TIG welding with that. I thought the pedal was pretty good. The torch is pretty good. It is only 180 amp rated torch, but as long as you're running it for short amounts of time, it doesn't matter. I mean, I don't think you can run it for long enough on this machine to make that a problem. So yeah, I'd say all in all, I'm impressed with this machine. It definitely is a great, if you were to buy one machine for your shop and you didn't have a lot of room, something this or something like it, doesn't matter what color box it came in, but that level of quality, and I think you'd be very happy. But I think a lot of people would find that 200 amps would be limiting. I think 250 to 300 amps is a much better place. But it just depends on how far you're gonna go with it. So take that for what it's worth. This is the Miller DialArc 250 TIG on steel test.
Contact.
Guys, this is the ESAB TIG weld. This is the DialArc 250. And I think any differences can be, between the welds can be put down entirely to my skill level. They both use 2% lanthanated. They both use the same piece of filler rod. In both cases, the weld looks good. The machines are very smooth to run. Yeah, so all in all, I think it's great. Alright, this is the Miller DialArc 250 aluminum TIG test. This is lanthanated tungsten. And yeah.
Contact. Oh, crap.
I went too hard.
Round two.
Thank you. this is the aluminum weld I did with the... Oh, crap, that whole thing's hot. Okay. This is the aluminum weld I did with the ESOB. This is the aluminum weld I did with the Dial-Arc 250. To me, they look pretty similar. I think there's more cleaning action in the ESOB, I'd guess. I did burn a hole through that, but that's also because the Dial-Arc 250 technically goes up to 310 amps. And so I have a lot more power, whereas on the ESOB, I was basically maxing it out to be able to do this weld. So it's worth noting that. And yeah, let me get you guys a close-up, maybe. Ow. Ow. There you go. I'm going to get set up on the SynchroWave 300, and we're going to finish this bad boy off. All right, guys, this is our third and final contestant on The Price Doesn't Matter. This is the Miller SynchroWave 300. One difference also, I'm not using a foot pedal. I'm using a hand control because I like them, and I have one for this. So there you go. Everything else is pretty the same. This is a little bit of a fancier torch in that you can bend the head around a little bit. I don't know. It seemed like a nice feature. And this is a water-cooled torch, whereas both the previous torches were air-cooled. So same thing, steel test, yada yada. We'll get it going. This is the Miller SynchroWave 300 TIG steel test. Contact. So that was the Miller SynchroWave 300 steel TIG welding test. So we've got the ESOB right here, the Dial-Arc 250 right there, and the 300 there. They all seem about the same. I definitely noticed, though, between the Dial-Arc 250 and the 300 running them side by side like this, the 300 just feels smoother. And I don't know how else to describe that. I don't know the proper terminology, but it just feeds it better. So yeah, I don't know. I like the 300 amp the best out of all three of these, but then again, I'm definitely biased. So take it as what you will. Okay, this is the SynchroWave 300 AC test. Take one, I guess. I had some trouble with my hand positioning getting it the way I wanted it to, but and this time I'll leave it in the clamp so I don't burn myself. But there you go. I mean, it's definitely welding nice and smooth. It's got a nice shine to it. I was definitely holding back on this, and a lot of this is to do with the variation of the quality of the welds is more to do with me than with the machine. But this definitely does aluminum much smoother, and it might just be the power, but it just seems like it goes through better. I did set the wave balance to 70% for more cleaning action for what I'm doing. And if you notice at the end, it kind of went down small and then turned off slowly. And that was a crater fill feature with this machine has, which is super useful because I have a tendency to snap my welds off, which leaves holes in aluminum. So as you can see, the end of my weld, it doesn't even have like that characteristic dimple you usually get, like on this one has that dark dimple, and even this one has the dark dimple. So yeah, so that's about it. That's the last one. All right, well, that's it for the TIG showdown between Big Blue and that's where that was. Anyways, between Big Blue and the other two contestants, one of which is also Big Blue, I guess, but I think it was worth me getting the SynchroWave 300. It's definitely welds smoother. As far as a transformer machine welding better than an IGBT machine, I think it all comes down to the quality of the machine. I was using a pretty high end for what it was multi-process machine for my multi-process work. And,
but these are also very high-end Transformer machines. So I don't think it matters so much the age of what you buy so much as the quality of what you buy. Though, with this machine, you can get the factory technician's manual from your local Miller dealer. They can get that from Miller for you. It's usually free, and it has a lot of information. This, all the components in this are discrete electric components that you could solder off a board and re-solder yourself versus, you know, the ESOB, which I'm pretty sure if you got a bad board, you replace the board or the whole machine. So I should be able to keep a machine like this working for a long time, and I'm keeping it in a dirty, unheated, uncooled, humid environment. So for me, this is the machine. Your mileage may vary. If you've got small work to do, that ESOB is a very nice machine. I can't say enough good things about it, especially for MIG welding. So yeah, choose your own adventure, but there are a lot of pieces of old iron out like this for real cheap money. And I'd look at one before you go buying something else. Though, be warned, this weighs 800 pounds. So yeah, call all your friends. Have a good week.